every time.
There's three people that work on this show, and none of them are in the studio. Gio, thank you. Where is Spanish?
I believe he's in the restroom.
Time it out. Please go get Tom Segura and bring him in the studio. Jesus Christ.
You
look
sacrifice.
At the clock before you go.
You sacrifice. You sit here and have to
wiggle. I have to urinate like you don't know.
Right.
And then Spanish is gone.
By the way, I went out and used the bathroom and got more water. And
Carmen excused. Carmen is on assignment right now.
Right.
Getting breakfast. It's ridiculous. There's Tom Segura. How you doing, pal? I have to tell you right away, I feel awful that you are here.
Why?
Because I know you don't want to be here. Like,
no.
I know. Like,
according to Bert,
Bert's
got to
be so messed up mentally that you are here. I don't know Tom really well at all, but I've become a fan in the last couple of years. And
well,
now,
thanks.
Yo, and I enjoy. I mean, we put a lot of people on that I don't like, but if we have somebody that I like on the show, like, I want him to have a good experience. Bert has mentally effed me on this entire appearance.
Yeah, that's just, you know, he's just playing games, man.
Yeah, he is. You know why? Because he's racist.
And he's fat and racist, yeah.
That's double true. Whammy.
Bert KKK Kreischer. Yeah.
The camaraderie between the two of you has gotten so much. Like, even he the other day when he tweeted out his tour dates over the Your Face. I thought that was hilarious.
That was very funny, yeah.
And he did, but he did say something about you yesterday. We talked to him, and I told him that you were coming on the show.
Yeah.
I had to wait till the last minute because I didn't want him to try and call and convince you not to do it. And then I told him yesterday, and I go, I got to tell you, I'm a little bit intimidated, and I'm usually not. And he goes,
what?
Why? He goes, why? Because time is silent and unapproving. I said, yes.
Yeah, I mean, you know, we have this great balance to our dynamic, right? The two of us, and he's fun, and I'm not. So, I think that's probably why we get along so well for a long time. But I mean, I was excited to come in, and then the cherry on top was that you told me Bert loses money if I come
$600.
In. $600. So I was like, I'm in.
He came in here all stacks of, he's Hollywood Bert now all day long.
Yeah,
you guys ruined him.
Yeah.
He comes in here with stacks of money all laid out on the table.
Oh, my God.
And he's like, this is my merchandise money, blah, blah, blah. And I started talking about you, and you and I had already talked.
Yeah.
And you said you were going to come in, and I go, you know, Tom's coming in. And he goes, I'm going to call him right now. I go, I'll call him right now. I have his number. You don't have the right number. I got the right number. And I'm like, well, okay. And he goes, I'll bet you all this money right here, Tom Segura will not be in studio. And I was like, how much is there? And he goes, like $600 and some. I go, all right, I'll collect it.
Damn, he doesn't sell that much merch, but that is cool that he loses it. You better collect.
Yeah, I will. I'll beat it out of him.
All right. That was what I was most excited about.
Now, you know, you have been on this show one time before.
I have.
You've never been in studio. Let's take you down the road of our relationship.
Okay.
Because it's really Bert's fault. The first time you came in was before, I don't even know if you and Bert were that tight at the time. Your wife was here in her only debut with April Macy, and we were doing afternoons.
Okay.
We didn't know either one of them, and the club sells us on April is really hot. She's with another girl who's really hot, and we're like, all right, we like hot girls. Bring them in.
Sure.
Turns out they were both great guests on the radio.
Oh, that's great.
April Macy's a great guest on the show. I have never seen her do comedy, but she's been on the show like 7 times.
Yeah.
Because she's good when she's on the show. We put tarantulas on her. We let her do whatever we want.
She's game.
Your wife was killed. Like, she was great. And your wife, this was 8 years ago, maybe. I don't know if you had
maybe
any kids
even more than
or whatever.
That, yeah.
She was looking pretty sexy, and at one point we asked her if we could see her boobs, but it wasn't like, hey, can we see your boobs? It came up in conversation about boobs, and she was like, I would show them to you, but I have to ask my husband. And we were like, all right, call him up and ask him. What does he do? And she's like, he's a comic. So we called you,
and
you were typical Tom. You were like, what? And you were like, I don't care. And you were like, nah, I don't know. You were fine. Like, you were like any husband.
I'm surprised I wasn't like, yeah.
You might have been a little, but then I think, I you know, if I'm a husband and I'm talking to my wife, I go, yeah, don't show these douchebags your boobs. Afternoon drive in Tampa. No thanks. Save it for the bigger markets.
Right.
So it wasn't like, it wasn't a bad thing. We were just like, oh, all right, whatever. And it was wrapping up the interview.
Okay.
Then you were on the show. Then Bert is, you're coming to Tampa and Bert is pushing you on us. hardcore. He's like, you'd have Tom on you. No, I probably would have had you on either way just because the club would have said, hey, this guy's funny.
Yeah.
And I was, all right.
Also, prior to that.
Well, this is what I was leading up to.
Yeah.
He ruined his reputation with recommending guests on our show.
That sounds very Bert.
Yeah. He pushed Bob Biggerstaff on us. Do you know that guy?
I know Bob. Yeah.
He tanked hard.
Oh, he did?
Yeah.
But wait, tanked in that, like, it just, you guys just didn't click? Or?
No, we clicked fine. He just wasn't funny.
Oh.
And then he was using, like, old. I mean, this is like 10 years ago. So it was no big deal. And then we're like, well, now we're not going to try. And then Bert wanted it so bad that it automatically turned me off. I was like, now I don't like the guy. Now I don't want him on the show. And I didn't even know you at all.
And yeah. I feel, I'm by the way, I'm just like you with that when people are like, you got to do this.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Or you got to watch this show. You have to talk to this person. I'm like, nah, dude. Yeah. No, yeah. I don't. That's my favorite thing about that is like, no, I don't.
No, right, yeah. Right. Yeah. I know. These guys have been trying to get me to watch MacGruber for a lifetime now, and I'm like, I don't want to watch it because you want me to watch
it
so bad.
Yeah, stop asking me to watch it.
But I also don't care that
you're right, right, right.
I'm just telling you, it's funny. Watch it if you want to.
Yeah. I care. You should watch it.
Thank you. So then, years later, I'm up in Opie and Anthony's studio, and you're on the air with Rogan and Ricky Gervais.
Oh, yeah.
And
I ran into you in the hallway.
Yeah,
I remember that.
I just stopped up to say hi, and I'm in the production studio sitting behind you. You have your back to me, and I'm watching Rogan and Gervais debate hunting and animal care and all that. And they were really going at it. It was good radio, and you just kind of, and so did Opie and Anthony, you kind of just sat back and kept your mouth shut. Now I'm texting Bert. 32 minutes, Segura hasn't said a word. Carried on, But then I talked to you afterwards, and you were such a nice guy. Then fast forward again to last year, and your special came out, and I'm like, all right, now everybody's at Netflix special. I'm like, let me watch this thing. I got to tell you, I tweeted you, I tweeted Bert, I called my mother, I told everybody. I'm like, this is the funniest goddamn thing. I also, at the same time, discovered edible pot.
Nice.
I'm never really a pot smoker.
Yeah.
But then they put it in candy form, and then I started to do it a little bit, which I don't anymore. I gave up after a year. But I will tell you, the highest I've ever been was watching you do the thing where you speak different languages and different, like when you see different people speak the different. I just lost my mind driving home with tears out of my eyes. And then I think Bert got mad at me because I called and told him how funny you are.
Thanks, man.
And that ruined it.
That's very nice of you. Thank you. I appreciate that. Thanks so much.
It's the truth, man. So now you've got huge success. And you still don't seem very happy.
No, I mean, this is pretty happy for me.
This is a happy look?
This is a pretty enthusiastic
look. What do you do during the day? What is a fun day for you?
Because
Bert said we get along very good. Bert goes, you guys only care about eating and
Porsches.
Yeah, and Porsches.
What was up? I thought I was getting picked up in a Porsche this morning.
Well, so my buddy Pete owns a boutique car dealership that sells high-end cars.
The one, the video that Bert did, that Porsche, that was at
where
Pete's
he came
place.
Down the stairs.
So I called Pete, and I was like, can we get Tom in a Porsche? Pete's like, yeah. And then afterwards, Pete's like, I have no Porsches left. I'm sold out.
I
go, well, you better go find one.
Yeah, go get a Porsche, dude.
Yeah. I was like, he's like, the only one I have is on consignment. I don't own it. If somebody takes it out and wrecks it, I'm going to be tied to it.
Probably smart move by that guy.
Yeah. So, because bad things will happen to us if possible.
I don't know. Don't you feel like, I mean, you're a routine guy for sure, right?
Yeah,
you
do. I have no choice.
So it's like, yeah, I feel like I'm pretty into a routine. I mean, touring is disruptive to routines.
Right.
But other than that, it's like we have a Tuesdays like our podcast day.
Yeah.
Wednesday's always like personal day. I have two young kids.
How old are your kids?
3 years old and about to be 8 months old. So, it's just like a lot of home life stuff.
At your age, that's a rough game.
Yeah, man.
I imagine we're close, similar in age.
Yeah. And so it's like, and then, doing spots, but it just feels all pretty much like the routine. I mean, nothing exciting, Nothing.
No.
Nothing fun.
All right, let me answer this. What would you do if you were retired? What do you want? Like what? Because all I want. In my mind, I lay in bed at night and I fall asleep by thinking about, I fantasize about retirement.
Right.
And in my mind, I've had this cabin in the middle. I say Montana, but I've only been to Montana once.
I say Montana sometimes too.
I wanted to be away from people in the snow. I wanted to be cold and away from people. And in my fantasy, nobody else is in the cabin except for me. I think I left the family
Yeah. My wife got mad at me because I'm turning 40.
Right. And, I'm way older than you.
I'm turning 40, and I just look bad. But I'm turning 40. I have a weathered, beaten, not healthy look. But, yeah, it's crazy, man. It's my whole life, too. Like, when I was 17, people were like, are you 36? I was like, no. I'm a junior in high school now. But my wife was like, what do you want to do for your 40th? And I was like, you know what I really want to do? I want to go to the track. And with some of my friends and do just laps. And she was like, can I be involved? And I was
what
like,
do you mean? Well, with like what? Racetrack?
And she was, yeah.
Oh, and, I didn't know what you meant. Yeah. I thought you meant the horse track.
No, no. Just driving.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And she was like, can I be involved? And I was like, I mean, not for that part.
Yeah.
And then she's like, well, it's your 40th. And I was like, right. Yeah. So I'm going to go have fun with my friends.
It's like a bachelor party.
She's like, I'm your wife. And I was like, exactly. And then I'll come home. And I'll be like, hey, I had fun today. Like, that's.
I have a cake ready for me. Yeah. That's your portion of it.
Yeah. And she's like, what about the kids? I'm like, the kids definitely can't come to the track. Like, what are you talking about?
They don't even have a license.
Yeah, but I want to be alone. But I love her. Don't get me wrong.
How long have you been married?
10 years now.
Okay, so I've been married, it'll be 16 years this month, and I feel the same way. My wife, like, if I want to go to Vegas, my go-to is my wife. I go, you want to go? She'll gamble, she hangs out.
Yeah.
She's cool, but there are certain things in my life I don't want her to be involved in. And it has nothing to do with other girls or anything like that. I don't. Although, I have to say, if I was a comedian, and I left, like, every Wednesday to go on the road, I'd be banging chicks in every city possible.
If you were that, that's the thing is like you think that, but it's like if you're that guy. Like there are those guys who, and it makes, you're like, oh yeah, he's out there just crushing.
I mean, I wouldn't want to find love. I'm not looking for a hot chick, but I'll take a pig or like something like that, something that nobody will ever know about that I'll never see
so
again.
Gracious of
sure.
I'm just being honest. I'm not getting tens. I'll take a six when nobody's looking. And
yeah,
I'm not doing that. But I would if I was in Iowa on a,
I think
on
if
Tuesday.
I'd started the road like that, you know what I mean? But by the time I was really working the road, I was already in a relationship. But I think if I'd started like that, because you meet that guy on the road a lot sometimes, you know, it's like he's single and just starting to travel and then it picks up. You're going to be that guy. And then you're not going to be able to not chase forever.
Sure, sure.
You know?
Was it hard? See, your wife's a genuinely funny lady.
Yeah.
But was it hard when she wanted to do, or whose idea was it to do the podcast together?
Actually, that was 100% Rogan's idea.
Of the two of you doing it?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I'd been opening for him. He had just started the podcast, I want to say, his in like 2009.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I'm opening for him where he's touring everywhere and I'm doing weeks with him and I'm guesting on his show a lot. It's like in his house on a couch, you know? And then he's like, you should start a podcast. And I had zero interest. And then he saw my wife at the Improv in Hollywood. And like, you know, the next day I ran into him. Like, I don't know if it was an airport or something. He was like, your wife's a comic, dude. This makes sense. Like, why don't you guys just do it? It's so easy. So he suggested it so many times that when I came home from one of those trips with him, I was like, so do you want to, like, I think we should do this.
Yeah.
I don't know. He keeps like suggesting, and I didn't think, I thought it would be like, I don't know, man, I thought like 50 people would listen, you know, which, you know, it probably did the
right,
first time, but
yeah.
I definitely didn't think it would be worth continuing to do.
I don't know, like, my wife is actually pretty funny.
And yeah.
We did a roast for me when I turned, I wasn't 40, was it?
Changing
it was,
the name.
Yeah, when I changed it, I used to be Cowhead, and when I changed the name, we had a roast, and the roast was great, and it had Norton and Bert and Bobby Kelly, like all our guys that we love. And my wife was like, what if I write some jokes? And I go, yeah, that'd be kind of cute. Get up there. And she just went up there and crushed it.
She did.
And she'd crush it. And I remember telling her while she's doing it, I'm like, you know, these guys are real comedians.
And yeah, yeah.
You don't get too crazy. Because she had some cut jokes on them. Like, she was cutting on them. And I was like, you know, don't get too crazy with it because you don't want to look. And she just crushed everybody. I mean, she did a great job. And she's dying to do something together, like a podcast or something.
Sure.
I genuinely think she'd be funny, but I don't know. Like, what if it's not? How do I tell her this is awful? And
you
it
know,
may not be you.
But you're such a seasoned broadcaster that you would make the fact that it's not working work.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, you would make it, because you've done million hours of radio, you would end up making that entertaining.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I built the studio in my house, and I have no idea what the purpose is.
Oh,
so
do
I
your show with her, man.
Yeah, well, I told her, once we get everything locked in, we'll at least run some test shows. And
you got to do that.
So that Galvin
Wait,
can make
Wait, but
fun
back
of me.
To, you know, Montana.
Yeah. Let's
so
go,
don't
me
you
and
feel
you.
Like, yeah, you feel like you're like, I want to go be alone in the cold and just get away. But even if you're like, hey, you got all the money today, it's here, go do it, you get a thrill out of doing good radio, right? Like, even on a great radio day, you're like, that's a good day.
Yes.
And that's why you really can't pull the trigger on
that.
But
you could do that from anywhere now. Like, I
guess.
Yeah, I don't know. I'm thinking in my mind, this is the truth. I can fall asleep anywhere, anytime. I've slept during commercials here.
Yeah.
Just a little power nap.
Middle of conversation, just pass right out.
Be more entertaining. What do you want from me?
Yeah.
I don't, it's not my fault. I told Robert Kelly the other day, he was like, man, I'm getting old. I can't sleep anymore. He's like, I sleep like 2 hours. And I go, I can sleep anywhere for as long as I want. And he goes, don't say it like it's a superpower. It's not because you're fat and unhealthy. I said, okay, but I've always been this way. But what I have to do is I have to get in bed and I have to get comfortable, and then I have to like daydream a little bit. Like, still sometimes I'm in concert in high school, or if I'm in a fight somewhere or something.
Yeah.
But for what really gets me to go to sleep is designing my cabin. I never actually finish designing it. In my head, I fall asleep, and I'm like, this is it. But in my mind, I have a big white beard, and I'm wearing clothes that I've never worn before, and I chop wood.
I'm
a new guy.
I'm into it.
Yeah, right?
I think of a ranch, like Colorado ranch or something.
I thought about that too, but I thought about it's probably good for a post-apocalypse to have some sort of animals or something,
mm-hmm.
but I don't want the responsibility.
No. That's the thing is in my fantasy, like someone else is like taking care of it.
Yeah.
And then they're like, jefe, and I'm like, hey, and then, you know, motorcycle. Like, I don't know how to drive a motorcycle,
right.
but in my fantasy, it's my ranch. And I'm like, wow. Yeah.
By the way, the vehicle that I sent you for your Montana cabin and
beautiful.
Stuff, I just sent to Joey if he has it up on Bone TV.
Yeah, I have.
It's perfect for snow.
And by the way, you know, you said like you can do radio from anywhere now. That is one of my favorite, like, ridiculous radio things is when you go to guests somewhere and they'll be like, it's usually like in a cold place.
Yeah.
You know, like you're in Des Moines or something. They're like, you know, the host, like, John. By the way, this is the John Show.
Uh-huh.
John lives in Palm Beach, and that's where he's at right now.
Yeah,
and you're like, okay.
Uh-huh.
And then they're like, don't say that he's not here, though. And you're like, all right. And then they don't even give you a monitor, like nothing to look at. So you walk in.
Sitting in a room by yourself.
Yeah, he's like, nice black jacket. And you're like, yeah, thanks, man. And then, you know, you're like, yeah, it's good to be here. He's like, ah, yeah, so cold out, right? And you're like, dude, what is going on?
I don't understand that. So I built this studio, and everybody's like, oh, you're going to broadcast from home? And I went, no. And they're like, why? I go, because that's just lazy. That's me sitting in my underwear in a room watching Oprah while I'm pretending to be talking. It's just terrible radio. But if I had to do it in another city and I had to do it from there in addition to this or whatever, then I can do it. So what radio do you – like, you don't do a lot of morning radio. You don't have to. Clearly, you have three shows at the Tampa Theater that are sold out, and which is interesting because this is really the first time you've done radio in Tampa.
Yeah.
In the 10 years since we had you on before, like these people only know you from your comedy and your podcast.
Right.
And that's great that you've sold out three shows. So what do you, like, what cities do you do regular radio in? Anybody? Like, I know radio, I don't hate radio shows. And I know some shows from Bert. I know Todd and Tyler. I've never heard their show, but I know he loves them in Nebraska.
Oh, yeah, that's right. I remember that. Yeah.
And then there's
Preston and Steve.
Yeah, that he loves.
Those guys are great. I like Preston
Philly.
And Steve a lot. I like them a lot.
So I don't get to hear a lot of these shows, but I know of these people.
Yeah.
What in LA, do you do anything?
No.
Nothing. Mm-mm. Who do you listen? Do you listen to anything?
You know, in my car, I have, I didn't sign up for, you know, satellite radio.
Right.
And so it's almost always on K-Day there. So that's like Big Boy in the morning.
Yeah.
L.A. staple for like, you know, he switched his stations.
He's not so big anymore, right?
Exactly. Now. Yeah. No, he's lost hundreds of pounds. But I mean, so that's on in my car in the mornings. But I don't know. Here's the thing about, I don't dislike radio at all.
Yeah.
What happens is when you're coming up through the clubs, they make you do a lot of press.
Right.
Let's just press as an umbrella term.
Yeah.
And they make you do a lot of it in a lot of markets where you can be on shows for hours and kill. Like literally, the guys are like, this is such a great day here. And you could do the morning, Good Morning Television, you know, like the Good Morning Hartford
show. Which
seems
to be the most awful thing to do.
And then you go to the shows, and like, let's say it's half full, right?
Yeah.
You're like, all right, well, and then you go like, who heard me on the radio? And then it's like one hand. So you're like, why are you making me do this?
Yeah.
And it's because in a lot of places, it's like to maintain that relationship, and you're like, I don't care. It has nothing for me.
I don't hold that against a club if I'm like, we had somebody scheduled to come in, And I knew, I looked at the sheet and I go, he's not going to come in studio. And they were like, oh, we got him booked. And I go, no, who was it? And then canceled. D.L. Hughley or somebody?
No, Arsenio Hall.
No, but we had Arsenio on the phone. It was somebody, like, I don't want to do phoners on anybody.
I don't like phoners.
But Arsenio is a television legend. And I had things to talk to him about.
Yeah,
like,
sure.
He's worth it.
I'm even worse on phoners.
Oh,
I mean, I'm bad in studio on the phone.
I mean,
a disaster.
It's a delay and we can't see each other.
Yeah.
And if I start talking about something and I see the guy go, then I know he doesn't want to talk about it, which either means talk more about it or depending on who the guest is.
John in Palm Beach doesn't know that.
No.
Or maybe he does. He saw your black jacket.
So. Yeah, that's right. No, there's a, I mean, look, so. I don't get a lot of radio requests at all. I get like some print stuff and, you know, and I do get asked to do some phoners, and it's fun to do the ones that, like, I don't know, where you feel like it's fun to do, you know? And like, so I've called into Preston and Steve.
Oh, you have?
And I've called into Bennington and had a great time with them. But like, and I've gone into Bennington. I love that guy.
Yeah, he's the best.
But I mean, on a regular basis, I'm probably not on calling in or on any regular show.
I don't like when Bert does other shows. It makes me jealous.
Yeah.
A couple that he can do that I accept, like Elliot and Preston and Steve and all that. But when he, like one time I was walking by my my office one day at home. My phone was ringing. I answered. I go, hello? And I go, oh, God. Yeah, he's like, I'm on the air with Todd and Tyler, and they want to know how much money you make. And I'm like, oh, okay.
Of course he called you that.
But I didn't care. I was like, all I know is if I tell you and they make more than me, I'm going to kill myself.
Yeah, on the phone.
So, I love talking about that kind of stuff. It's not I'm making more than you. Don't you ever like wonder what people make? Like whenever that Sunday newspaper does that, Parade magazine does what people are making, and they go, "This guy's a nurse."
I read that thing line by line.
Right, you want to know? You just I have natural curiosity, and then you kind of want to compare it to you. But I want to know where I am at, where I'm at in the game. Nothing makes me feel better than my when my son was born. Somebody bought me one of those things. I don't remember. It was like all the things that happened on that day, what the number one single was. And then it said average household income was like $68,000.
Isn't that nice?
I was like, that makes me feel so good.
Yeah.
So that's what those are the kind of things that I
can't understand. I love knowing, by the way, among comedians, what people's deals are, ticket prices. Like,
Bert will tell you.
Oh, of course. but we study those things. Now, he and I will actually trade details, which like people never do, which is stupid because you kind of
that's how you get everybody
and you inform yourself and you learn, like, you know, like it's like a NFL, you know, players union. It's like you start understanding, but like nobody likes to talk about that. Bert, I mean, I'm surprised he just doesn't tweet it out. He's like, this is what I made. This is my last show.
He walked around with a piece of paper that gave him his guarantee for all of his tour. And I go, are you making good money on tour? You just want to see? He takes the paper out and shows it to me. I'm like, oh, good for you.
Yeah.
He always says, Bert says a lot. He says, what he learned from you is that he can say no to stuff.
Yeah, except he doesn't.
Yeah.
No, he's the best, man. But he's hilarious. He'll put that out there.
I love it.
Yeah.
His honesty is what makes him so, his vulnerability is what makes him so funny to me.
Absolutely. And the funny thing is, like, now, I mean, he's going to be insufferable soon because a year ago he was like, I'm making so much money right now. and now I know he's definitely making more money. So it's going to be unbearable.
When Twitter first started, he's like, man, you got to help me get Twitter followers. And then the next time I saw him, he's like, how many Twitter followers do you have? Like, he had like 200,000 more than me. TV does it.
He's good at social media, though, because he loves it. That's the thing. I think he actually loves making videos. You know what I mean? Like, he loves creating content, and then, I don't know.
And he's funny. Like I'll thumb through it, and I'll watch a couple of seconds, and I'm like, he's always got something. Like, I did a panel one time about social media with the lady who does social media for Coca-Cola.
Yeah.
And she was like, the number one thing I learned is don't put anything out there unless it's great. And I thought, I don't do that. I just put mediocre stuff out all day. Yeah. Bert's are usually pretty great. Like, he does a good job.
His videos, like his promo stuff is definitely, I'm like, how much time did you spend on this? He was like, an afternoon. And I'm like, for your Instagram post?
Yeah.
But I mean, that it looks good.
Yeah, it's a good life. Tom Segura is here with us. Now, I believe, are all the shows sold out?
Yeah, I think so.
That's pretty wonderful.
That's what they told me.
Yeah, the Tampa Theater, have you played there? You know that theater?
Well, I don't.
You didn't last time.
By the way, you know, I took that because I DM'd with you.
Yeah.
And I asked you. And you said that's, you're like, that's where people do specials at. That's what you should do.
That's where Bert went. It's interesting because it's a beautiful. Have you seen the theater yet?
I did see it.
It's a beautiful theater.
Yeah.
And I love that they still do shows there. First time I ever went there was to see Andrew Dice Clay. Didn't quite fit. But everybody else that I've seen there has been great.
Yeah.
And it's just an old, the atmosphere is fantastic.
It's beautiful. Yeah. It's a beautiful space.
Yeah. So, but don't, good luck going if you want to go.
Yeah, they might have released, you know, sometimes like day of, they release like some holds, like 10, yeah. 20 tickets or
Are
something.
Are you with anybody? Will you have anybody open for you?
Yeah, yeah. I brought Pat House from Philly down.
Okay.
Great comic.
I don't know who that is.
Yeah, he's very funny.
Now, I might need to go to see this show.
Yeah.
I thought it was only one night, and my son
tonight
has
and tomorrow.
His first. Yeah, I didn't know tomorrow. Yeah. Oh, tonight.
Tonight, yeah. Tonight's one, and
what's today?
Tomorrow's
Thursday.
Two. Yeah, yeah, that's what
oh,
it is.
Oh, I didn't know there was one tonight. Maybe I'll go tonight.
Come tonight.
Because my son has his first football game tomorrow.
Oh,
I can't miss that.
Of course
he'll
not.
Be gay if that's, I miss,
yeah,
if I didn't go to his
sure.
first football game.
Yeah.
Something, or he'll kill people in college.
I mean,
like, you didn't even go to my game.
He'll try stuff just to spite you.
Right.
Yeah.
Right, exactly.
What position is he playing?
Well, I don't know. He's 12 years old, and he made the varsity team.
What?
Yeah, and he was playing.
What?
Yeah, and he was playing defensive tackle, but last night the coach was like, he wanted to play offense, so we put him on offense.
Wait a minute. He's 12?
Yeah.
For real?
Yeah, for real. He's a big kid.
How's he on the varsity?
He went there, and there's the midgets before varsity.
Yeah.
And he went out and stood there with the midgets, and I looked at the coach, and I go, he's going to kill somebody. He's 2 feet taller than any kid out there.
How big is your kid?
He's not. I mean, if you saw him in here, you wouldn't be like, wow, that kid's big. But if you were like, oh, he's 12, that's pretty big.
Yeah, for 12. Yeah, yeah. He's definitely.
So
we share clothes, his son and
yeah,
I.
Yeah, literally. Literally. They were at my house, him and Joe.
But wait, if he's going to play varsity.
Yeah.
You mean against, like, juniors?
14 to 16-year-olds.
Okay.
Yeah.
Poof.
Yeah.
Right?
16-year-olds. Those are some yeah. big 16-year-olds.
Well, he's like, I think the rumor got out. He's like, we're playing a team tomorrow night, and I go, yeah, Joe, they're all going to be big kids. They're all good. He goes, yeah, I guess they're all big black kids. And I go, well, I know that's more intimidating. I know that's scary, but you just do your best. I always tell whenever
they are better than you.
Whenever we have a black football player, we used to have a guy named Devin Joseph who played for the Buccaneers. He was a defensive player, and he had long dreadlocks.
Yeah.
Not dreadlocks, like braids.
Yeah.
And I go, I'm going to tell you a secret because you're on our team that nobody's going to tell you. White people are inherently afraid of big black people, so know that if you line it up against a white guy, no matter how confident he looks, he's still a little bit scared of you.
Mm-hmm.
And that works for him, you know, and it's true.
Was he like, yeah, I already know that.
Yeah, yeah. Yeah. He was like, why? I'm so sweet. I go, he's not worried about how sweet you are.
I've been black my whole life.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So he's playing, and I don't know what position he's going to play, but I'm very excited to see.
Dude, him. Yeah, that's awesome. I would cancel my show to go to that show, to go to watch that.
I think I'm going to come tonight then.
That'd be great,
all
man.
All right, that'll work.
That'd be great.
Tom Segura is here with us now. I know I saw your Instagram yesterday. I assume you've watched the Michael Jackson documentary.
Oh yeah.
Is that not the? I mean, we all kind of knew.
Of course,
but I don't
we knew.
Need to hear about look kids' butts.
Horrible.
It's really been.
He definitely
did it, right?
Oh yeah.
Yo,
like who's watching?
What
this
is wrong
now
with you
going?
If you're out there and you're like, but I mean, did you not read the case files? Yeah. Yeah, no, I did.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's a pervert. He's a pedophile. He's a molester.
I know. Sure. I mean, like, it's really.
It for is, sure.
I mean, what do you think? Pedophile or you think he. I mean, definitely pedophile.
I think he's a serial sexual predator, for sure.
Do you or do you think it's because he has a different mental issue? Like, I wonder. My whole thing was I didn't think Michael Jackson, before this, I didn't think he was necessarily a pedophile. What I thought was he was stuck in some sort of child mode because he had trauma in his youth, probably was gay and was afraid to tell anybody about it, and found comfort in non-sexual things like kids and all that. But then I saw this thing and I was like, "Whoa, I was wrong." I'm no expert.
I don't know. I think you definitely nailed it that there's a lot going on.
Yeah.
And I think, you know, he definitely was a victim of abuse himself.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of trauma there. But I mean, we all were like, you know, in that era, like, yo, this dude's a grown man just hanging out with like 10-year-old boys.
Yeah. Like show up to big things when like you brought Webster.
And by the way, we should all be equally critical of, you know, the parents who are like, yeah,
oh, yeah.
Like, hang out with, and then he could sleep in your room in, for a month. Yeah. That's fine.
Yeah. Yeah. That was
all that crazy stuff.
Also,
but
we got a house, so that was nice. Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, look, there's a lot of people complicit in that thing. Staff, I'm sure.
Oh,
you know.
Staff.
And if you read like the 1993 or 2005, especially the 2005 details.
Yeah.
In those case files, there's a lot of staff that corroborate.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they're like the from security to maid to cook, talking about, you know, what they saw. So it's not like
they probably had to all sign non-disclosure agreements.
I'm sure.
And they were all afraid that they would lose their job at Neverland.
Of course,
you don't want to do that. Although I did say the other day, and I was pretty positive. Like I grew up a really poor kid.
Yeah.
And if I was living in the Berry Home Projects and Michael Jackson one day was like, come to Neverland.
Yeah, no.
And we went to Neverland and he was like, just touch my wiener. I'd be like, do I get to stay?
Yeah,
I probably would have done it.
Yeah, yeah, of course. I mean, the allure, the seduction, right, of like the fame. And look, I mean, I would forget about this creep and then hear like anything off the wall or Thriller. And you're like, this is dope.
Right.
This is
right, right, right.
You know? And then even like yesterday I heard a song. I was like, this is the jam.
I'll never stop listening to Ignition. I don't care how guilty R. Kelly is. That's the greatest song ever.
That song's amazing.
And what is it, Carmen? Oh, Carmen's on here. Carmen says it's raping music. Mm-hmm. But I still have to keep listening.
It's. Here's the thing. I'm not going to turn it off.
No.
I don't have to go put it on. But if you put it on, I'll be like, all right, we're listening to this song.
I think I watched the documentary and then put it on afterwards.
Yeah.
I was like, I saw Sam Morril yesterday on the show. I talked about watching the documentary with my wife in the middle of the day. We were both home alone. We taped it. We put it on and we were watching it. And we were laying in bed. And there was absolutely no chance we were going to have sex.
Hell no. After that.
It's so great. And then Sam Morril said, it was like, I was watching it with a girl. And I thought, and I tried to have sex with her. And she's like, no way.
Yeah.
It's just, it's so gross.
My penis went up and inside of me. Yeah. It's like.
It's, especially when you have kids. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like
yeah.
Did you watch Abducted in Plain Sight?
Yes.
What?
Okay.
What?
Yeah.
That's another. I can't even get my wife. She won't watch it.
Why?
Just that I go, just so you know, because I know how she is.
Right.
I was like, everything's all right now. So
yeah.
You know what I mean? I'll tell you the premise, but just know that like doesn't end terribly.
Right.
She was like, nope, don't want any of that in my head at all. None.
So
of
we
it.
Had her on the air last week.
You did,
Dan Broberg. Yeah. And now my wife's a therapist, so my wife's listening to the show,
God.
And my wife loved the abduction. She made me watch it. He made me watch it. So we're talking to her, and I said, do you think that your dad, and part of the reason why your mom and dad had such, you know, were able to get suckered in by this, is because your dad was a closeted homosexual and was able to have his first gay experience with this guy and then was so embarrassed by it that he used it against him. And she was like, my dad was a piano player and an artist and a twin. My wife's like, she clearly deflected your question. Didn't have any. Her dad was definitely gay, right?
Oh, yeah.
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 I mean, I don't everybody was so quick to say, like, I was defending
the parents. He's sweeter than sour sauce. You know?
Yeah. There's two scenarios how that ends. Either doing it and you're gay or you punch the guy in the face.
Right?
That's the two scenarios.
Dude, that guy must have been just one of these master manipulator deceivers, you know, when you lay out, but of course it doesn't, you know, explain how, like, the guy had to want to go in with that.
Right.
But that story,
you're watching,
you're like, no way.
Yeah.
The guy's like, I have this problem.
Yeah.
I don't know what to do.
I need relief.
I helped him out. Yeah.
I described it because I said on Twitter, I go, you're going to watch it. You're going to stop it multiple times and just stand up and go, what is going on?
Yeah.
I said at the 21-minute mark or whatever is the first one where you just go, okay, this is crazy.
It's crazy. And then when you don't believe it could get any crazier.
Oh, yeah.
Like when this poor child is returned to your home, you're like, I guess this is the end of the doc.
Uh-huh.
And it's like,
that was quick.
Nope.
Yeah.
Mom's gonna hook
more.
It up again. I mean, it's just
well, and the fact that it happened with multiple kids, like this was just one story of him doing this, but he did this with a number of other children. So think of what he did to those families.
But isn't there like some parallel to, like, because the thing is, one of the crazy things about this, and I'm so amused and entertained by the Michael Jackson backlash, like the defenders, the people who are like.
Yeah,
you know,
I got a couple of emails.
They go to the mat over this, man. It's like, then you see like the reaction to, you know, a guy like the guy in Abducted in Plain Sight, or like if you just, if I just drew up the picture of the Michael Jackson scenario, and instead of a famous pop singer,
right,
I was
right.
like, it's Kevin. He works at the gas station.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
wouldn't be like, man,
right.
but he, you know, he's a good dude. Yeah. like, and like people just love.
He's misunderstood and he had a bad youth. Yeah.
yeah, they'd love to defend it. And it's, I didn't think it was going to be that level. Where people.
No, but this is how it was with Bill Cosby in the beginning. All the black actors came out and they were like, how dare you? And then they all were like, all right, maybe. Except Faison Love. He's still holding strong.
He's hard on. He's hardcore.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
I love that dude, but that is one thing he's way off on is he still will he will not let the Bill Cosby thing go.
Yeah, I think that with the Michael Jackson, I think the real thing is that when you really love a musician, it becomes part of your identity. And you're like, I spent so much time listening, dancing, singing, letting it, you know, play in the car, going to concerts, putting posters that like you don't want to shed that part of your identity if you're a super fan.
Right.
So you do anything to try to defend, explain it.
Yeah. I don't know. I can't see getting caught up in any of that. Like I love Pearl Jam, but Eddie Vedder needs to shut up about politics. Like I can definitely look at it and say, when I was a kid, I used to love Prince.
Yeah.
Like when Purple Rain came out
sure.
and Little Red Corvette and all that, and I had Prince posters and all that. And my mother took me to some weird church and they convinced me that Prince was worshiped the devil, and I went home and took all my posters down.
Really?
Yeah, she really. My mother took me to some weird churches when I was a kid, and I was
think
afraid.
She set that up. She's like, we're talking about Prince today.
Yeah. No,
get him in there.
I think she liked Prince too, and we just realized that Jesus was more important than Prince.
Really?
And Prince came down, and then this weird church with traveling hippies that would come and draw pictures while they told stories. They gave me one of the pictures, so then that replaced my Prince poster. Like,
oh.
A picture of Noah's Ark made on chalk on paper. Oh.
How long did you stay in that lane?
Then, well, I'm trying to think. It was a couple of years.
Couple years?
Yeah, but like a couple of years, different churches. Like, we went to a Baptist church for a while, but it was like a Baptist church where the guy was like real handsome. You'd see him on TV, like one of those guys that had billboards.
Yeah.
And then, but at the same time, I went to Catholic school. And then we left that and went to some weird church. That was like a barn,
mm-hmm.
and that's where the traveling hippies who drew pictures came in. And I think my mom was just trying to find an identity and do the right thing with the kids, and she just kept getting, you know.
How did you stop,
in.
Or what led to you, you know what I mean, getting away from it? How'd you get away?
I don't know. I think my mom was, she was not dumb, and I think she wanted good in life, and that's why she did it. And then when she realized everybody's crazy.
Oh, okay.
Churches are all crazy, you know. But they had this special thing at the Calvary Baptist Church where they had this guy come with a mullet and a bunch of cassette tapes, and he played backward songs for us, and I wouldn't even look at Led Zeppelin.
Really?
Oh, man.
Well, yeah, as a kid, that'll really mess with your head.
Here, and none of it was real. It was all, if you listen to anything backwards long enough, you're going to start hearing something.
Right, yeah.
So it was a lot of,
And I'm like, there it is, man.
Did you hear it right there?
He said, stop drinking soda.
Yeah, and then they made me think Prince was bad.
Yeah.
And I had to take that down, and I lost a lot of stuff.
I went out with a girl that was half Korean, her mother full Korean, and they believed that Annie Lennox was the Antichrist.
Really?
Yeah, like full on. She
Why?
Because
she had short hair?
Religious. I don't know, but like full on super
I'm not,
religious.
I'm not so
Dude,
sure
look
that's
at your
true.
Head of hair. I'm just looking at that right
like
now.
That?
Right.
Yeah.
Thank you.
That's dope, man.
I'll look at it every day.
Yeah, I would like to borrow that.
Mm-hmm.
That's
hey,
good stuff.
How old's your dad?
My dad?
Yeah.
He's 71 or
oh,
two.
Oh, okay. Yeah. How's his hair?
Oh, he's got the horseshoe.
Oh, he does?
Just like, yeah, but he's had it like almost my whole life.
My dad's almost 70.
Full head?
Like a 60s doo-wop singer.
Yeah, that's not going anywhere.
No. Oh, but his father looks like he could be the president in any movie from the 80s.
Really?
Yeah, he's full head of hair, real distinguished looking. His whole family's got good hair. My brother had hair like you all of his life. Mm. And then like 5 years ago, comes home one day with a full head of hair, and I looked at him and I go, what? And he goes, I just decided to grow it out. I go, I didn't know you had the
what?
Option to grow
yeah,
it out.
Yeah, shaved down.
You've been shaving it
Dude,
down forever.
Burt's is so sad.
I know.
He's got like
we watch it over the years.
Oh, and then he's got the big
yeah.
spot in the back, and then he's got like this really sad hat collection that like he tries to make it like I got fedoras and stuff.
Yeah,
and,
but it's just
it's eccentric.
Spot.
His personality, yeah, and it's just like
he used to have that stuff that he put on
the sawdust.
Yeah.
I never got that.
He was like
he's putting the sawdust.
Oh, there it is.
X-Pac,
dude. Oh, there's so many holes. It's, look at me. Come on. He's basically...
Well, that's X-Pac, the wrestler. And that's Bert using his cinnamon on his head. Yeah. Whatever that is. I got to tell you, that's really good until you sweat it.
All right,
I couldn't... this is it. This is what I got. It's not my fault. It
Dude,
wasn't like
all
a,
I did is just take it down, man.
It wasn't like, oh, look at all the hair he had doing? There. Look at all the hair
He would. He would give you... Look how thin he is there.
Yeah.
It's got to be under three.
Where did you guys first meet?
We first met at the Brea Improv.
Uh-huh.
I was emceeing. He was middling for Jay Moore.
Uh-huh.
And, I met him at the show.
And do you instantly like him?
I'm trying to remember.
Because it seems to me he would annoy you.
You know, he actually, he was, if he would have really been himself, I'd been like, this guy's annoying. But he was a dialed down version of himself, I think, working that week.
Right.
And he was great on stage. So I was, you know, so if you're emceeing, you're watching the guy who's obviously ahead of you.
Right.
And I was like, wow, man, this dude, like, 'cause he was killing. I remember
that was the weekend that I got married.
Really?
16 years ago. Everybody was here. On a Sunday.
What year was that?
16 years ago. 2003.
Yeah, that would have been...
Oh, really?
Probably,
at the same time?
Probably when I worked. It was probably 03, yeah.
We went to see Jay because Jay was popular.
Yeah.
And whoever was left in town came with me to go see him on a Sunday night. And I saw Bert the next day. I'd never gone searching after who that person was more than I did. I called the club. I had to get the...
Really?
Yeah, and I had no idea he was from the area. And
oh, that's
some,
funny.
I talked about it on the air, and some lady's like, you know, he's from Lutz, and his dad is a lawyer here. And I went, oh, so that's how we were able to hook up.
The funny thing was I ended up coming here, and his family has a beach house.
Yeah.
So I stayed at the beach. I'd known him at this point not that much. And he was like, you stay at my beach house. Because, you know, a guy could walk down the street. He'd be like, you want to come to my house?
Right.
Like, just invite anybody to anything. So anyways, I'm staying at his house, and... he was coming to do radio. He must have been coming to do your show.
That's so funny.
All right, this is like now 04 or something.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, cool. And he, I remember he picked a bunch of donuts, and then he brought back donuts. And I was like, I like this guy. So anyways, we're talking. I'm asking him comedy questions. He's telling me all these stories. And I didn't know until we're in his house that he had gone to Florida State. And
right.
I'm a lifelong Florida State fan.
Oh, really?
And that's like... all I wanted to talk about was Florida State football, and he knows nothing.
Nothing about football, yeah.
So I was like, dude, you remember this game? He was like, I was probably there, but I was probably pretty drunk. So I was like, all right.
Yeah, of course he was there. He was there for 7 years.
Yeah.
He was there for all the good players.
I was like, dude, you were there like Charlie Ward. He was like, yeah, I think so. And I think we won a national championship. I'm like, you don't remember a national championship?
Right.
He was like, I think so. And then we went to the national championship game. He took me to the national championship game in 2013, where they beat Auburn in the fourth quarter on the final drive.
Uh-huh.
And I couldn't find him. I'm like, where are you? He's like, oh, I left. I was like, what? And he's like,
yeah.
I don't know. I just had to get home. I was like, do you know this isn't like a high school game, right? Like, this is the biggest game. He's like, what happened? I'm like, you won.
Yeah.
That's what happened. Your school won.
How do you become an FSU fan? Where'd you grow up? Did I ask you that already?
Well, I moved around a lot. I think it's like, you know, it's kind of in your house if like your dad's into a certain sport. So my dad loved college football.
Okay.
So we moved around, and then we ended up here in Florida. So I ended up in Vero Beach.
Oh.
And I was already a fan.
Right.
But then like once you're in the state, you kind of got to align yourself, right, with somebody. And especially it's the mid-90s. I mean, it was – or early 90s. So it was, you know.
That's why I don't like
the heyday
college ball.
Because of
– I grew up in New York.
Oh, yeah, of course.
Nobody really cared about college. I mean, we were, at the time, Syracuse.
Yeah, but
was
see,
a big team.
I remember being in school and like, or even out of it, and you talk to people who are like, college football sucks. Like, where are you from? They're like, New York. Like, yeah, because your college football sucks.
Right.
You know what I mean? But if you grew up here, you'd be obsessed.
Yeah,
here, you know?
Totally. And also, I didn't play in high school. If I did, I probably would have had more of an interest in what happens after
That's
high school.
True.
So,
yeah.
Tom Segura is in the studio with us. He has got three shows at the Tampa Theater that are most likely all sold out. Let's find out. I'm going to click on it and try and buy tickets. Tonight and two shows tomorrow, it is the Take It Down Tour. Now, will there be another? Oh, no, they're all sold out. Will there be another Netflix special, or what? How does that go?
I mean, you know, it's like a process. So we start talking to them and trying to target a date. And yeah, I mean, we'll, you know, if right. they make an offer, I guess we'll try to.
Well, I mean, you've had how many successful ones now? Three?
Yeah, three.
I mean, I went back and watched them all after the first one.
Oh.
They're all very funny.
Thanks, man.
But now everybody's trying to get Netflix specials.
It's huge.
But if you're the guy who stands out among the Netflix specials, that's a big deal.
Yeah, I guess. And then you also are thinking about, you know, everything happens in trends, I feel like, you know?
Yeah.
And so you go, well, it is the biggest thing, right? Now, for sure. But like, what's the next thing? Is the marketplace going to change?
Yeah.
Are other people going to? Because I mean, Gaffigan just did one at Amazon, so you go like, oh,
maybe
did he crack? Did he
spot.
Crack it? You know, is it going to be a big thing there now? I don't know.
Whose special gets more money, you or Bert? Did you compare notes on that?
Who what?
Who got more money?
Oh, I got more money.
You got more money.
Yeah, but I mean, I had done like that was the third one for them,
right?
So he might get a crazy raise on the next one. Yeah.
Because they have his two. They have both of his now. Right?
Yeah, and like clearly, that's the thing is like even though people get specials and there's a lot of specials, they don't all work, meaning like they don't all translate to, you know,
road success
and everything. So you can just tell, obviously, it worked for him, which means that, you know, I think of that as leverage for him, like that he'll go back and say, you know, obviously this is.
Sure, he's selling out.
But now Netflix, of course, releases zero data.
Right.
So you're like at the most unfavorable negotiating play.
Yeah.
You go like,
you can't say
you're like,
what
it went pretty well. And they're like, nah, it didn't go that well. And you're like, can I see? And they're like, of course not.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, look, the one good thing is you do have options now. So if that's the case, you can go. Or you can end up doing like Louis and eventually do your own thing.
Amazing what he was able to do.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, but do you remember that? So for people that don't know, Louis was doing his own special. This is before Netflix blew up.
Right.
And then putting on his website,
right,
selling it for $5. Mm-hmm. And like the first one was so massive and he made a crazy, like, I think he did a screen grab. He did like a Bert thing. He was like, look how much money I have. And he put it on and people were like, oh my God. And then other big, well-known comics were like, I'm going to do this. And they did not sell nearly as many.
Yeah.
So then you're like, then you would see on their site that the price of the special went from like $5.99 to $7.99 because they're trying to make as much.
Yeah. Yeah.
He had like a special thing going.
Yeah. I like this. I like being able to see the stuff on Netflix, watch it whenever I want again.
It's great.
And yeah, it's totally good. Tom Segura, go listen to the podcast, Your Mom's House. Oh, so briefly, what can you say about, I listened to it, but I don't know how it ended up.
Michael Jackson raped those kids.
Yeah.
The McDonald's thing.
Oh.
So I mean, I turned it on for 2 seconds and I was like, oh, this is not real. Like, I didn't know, like, where are you at with that? Like, I don't.
Oh, yeah. So you know, how it all panned out.
Yes.
You do. So for people that don't know, they offered us some money to sponsor our show. And we were like, no, I'm not going to take like a corporate thing to just like put your colors in my studio.
Uh-huh.
And then they called again and we're like, what if we offered you this amount of money? And we were like, no. And then like time passed and they're like, what if it was like a couple million dollars structured over a couple years? I was like, I'll definitely do whatever you want.
You can call me Ronald if you want to.
And then I don't know how they agreed to anything. And the first episode of our podcast in a new studio with McDonald's colors, we always play video clips, you know, like,
right, right.
So we like, it's like a clip show. Basically we play clips. Then we, you know, it's like a, I guess like almost like formatted in a way, like a radio show where it's like, we have time talking together, clips, and then guests. Right. So, but like that episode, we really focus on this guy putting a butt plug in.
Right.
And like, can you say that?
I don't know. I think so.
How about, okay.
Let's just, we already said it.
But I'm saying a guy using a device in a sexual manner where he goes poop from.
Right.
Okay.
I think you made it worse.
I did.
All right. We get it though.
But you get it. Okay. So a guy doing a thing. Anyways. We showed it a lot,
right.
and we dissect it, and we break it down, and we're showing it, and we have to censor for our video portion, part of the video,
right.
If we can't show it. Anyways, we spent like an hour on this guy, and then it goes up, and like within a day, they were like, "You're fired." I was like, "But this is consistent with what we do." And they were like, "Really?" I was like,
"Yeah,
nobody research." Yeah.
Oh, that is like, so funny.
Our show is gross, man. Yeah. it's always.
By the way,
gross stuff.
Thank you for making me uncomfortable with I think his name's Marty, the naked guy. England.
Yeah, dude. That
on my Twitter feed, I just see this guy dance around doing the hell, and I go, "What the hell's going on?" And of course, it was Tom who retweeted it because he found him, and then he wound up doing a video for you.
Yeah, so I retweeted. This guy is just out there. I think his name's Naked Martin, and he's just doing tweets naked. And he'll like,
he's
just
an old guy.
He's an older guy, right. And he dances. It was like Bee Gees, and like everybody was kung fu. Yeah. He does like a little dance, but he's naked. And at the end of his dance, he's got a nice.
That's what I would do if I was.
Me too.
It's
a nice piece of equipment for sure. And then he flaps it around, and then he's like, you know.
Right.
And then, so I see one of these. I just retweet it, and the one I retweet happens to really pick up.
Right.
Gets like 10,000 likes or something. And anyway, the next day he tweets out, I discovered I was retweeted by Tom Segura. I have no idea who that is. I was told he's a comedian. I'm very happy to see this or something.
Yeah.
So I just like engaged, and I was like, "My man, like it was an honor." And then he DMs me.
Oh, really?
And he's like, "I'm just really pleased by this. And if you ever need a video, just let me know." I was like, "As a matter of fact, there's a few I'd like you to make." So he started to do videos for me where he's like, as he's saying what I ask him to say. And then he's just like, and it upsets so many people.
I love that. Yeah. I love, I mean, we did years of getting girls naked in the studio.
Yeah.
But after a while, you're like, this isn't translating very well. This is before we had video a company here. And then we had the fetish girls would come in every once in a while when fetish cons in town. And they brought a guy in from Italy. He was a lawyer from Italy who likes to get kicked in the privates.
That's...
And they there's Marty.
Yeah.
See, now when I'm old, I'm his age. I'm just gonna take my wiener out wherever I want. Just be like, I'm old. Yeah.
I mean, that's not bad.
No, especially for an old man. Okay, so wait a second. I was gonna tell you. We started playing. All right, Carmen. When's enough? We started playing the Moose Soup Lady.
Yeah.
And then everybody's like, Segura loves that too. We put that in the end of our closing because that was the best.
The day that I heard that, I knew I'd found love. You know what I mean? Like that was gonna stay with us for a while.
Have you seen the Chubsy Wubsy story that we had? I bet he would love that.
Oh yeah.
Wait, isn't it hard, by the way, to watch the dudes getting kicked in the balls?
Yes.
Right?
Here's why, and I got to kind of be careful the way I describe it. He was in here, and he was naked, and the girl was doing it to him. Then she did it to him. Then the girl from the improv did it. Everybody was, like, getting their anxieties out.
Yeah, I was going to say, was that, like, cathartic to you?
No, I didn't want to do it. It's just, you know.
You get the opportunity.
Yeah, you get the opportunity.
So, like,
you want to know and do it.
Shoe?
Oh, I was wearing flip-flops, so it was barefoot, and I, like, crane-kicked him.
Yeah, like Karate Kid style.
You did?
Yeah.
But then what?
And right in the...
Yeah, and it was swollen because the girl before had been kicking it, like, a lot.
Yeah, yeah.
So it went from, like...
He's in his joy. He's in his glory.
Oh,
like, this is great.
He's hurt, and
then
he loves it.
Dropped down to his knees, and then he would get back up and be like, do it again.
Yeah.
Is he aroused?
No.
No,
no. He might have been...
Getting...
Yeah. But his area was like this.
Really?
Yeah, it was really weird and discolored and all that, and it was
I mean that's rough, man.
Yeah,
that's...
it was fun though.
That would be
fun. You know who else was here? Brad Williams was here that day.
Oh yeah.
So nothing like having a lady kick a guy in the nuts 100 times and a midget just sitting here watching along.
Yeah,
that makes
just...
things so much funnier.
I found that story. I have the audio if you would like to hear it.
Yeah, listen to this. This is something that I think that you would enjoy. This was a news story that we did the other day.
Okay.
God, play.
Last week on Thursday, the 14th, I ordered a product, and then on Saturday, I realized that I did not need the product anymore.
Vanessa Glue talking about this, something called the Pooch Patch from a company with the same name. The product was featured on our morning show a while back.
The Pooch Patch is great because it's a natural, organic way to get your dog to go and do their business.
But when Vanessa canceled her order and couldn't get a refund, she expressed her views online.
I really just wish that he would accept a simple bad review.
That bad review didn't go over well. Pooch Patch's president, by email, made some unusual remarks.
He emailed me to tell me that he looked at photos of me online and he thinks that I'm chubby.
In one email, the company tells her, looking a little chubs in that profile photo.
You don't talk to people or comment on their body or body shame them.
She told the company she planned to report the replies to a government consumer agency. The response from Pooch Patch, ooh, so scared, chubby wubby. I reported you to Jenny Craig, a well-known weight loss program. And on it went.
Saying that I needed to go to Jenny Craig, and he referred to me as Fatty McFatFat, and I did post it on my social media, and because of that, people in my following ended up leaving more bad reviews.
Oh, that's the best.
We're definitely going to play this.
Oh, I mean, is that not the best?
That's Fatty amazing. McFatFat. And I love to a vindictive, psychopathic CEO,
yeah.
Which fits the mold of how a lot of those guys are,
right.
But like most of them might have that thought, like, oh, look at this Fatty, I don't care, but like he's just like, I'm gonna send her messages.
Fatty McFatFat,
and I love that the reporter, ooh, chubby wubby.
Oh man,
that's insane. That's crazy, man.
I tried to get Bert to have to tweet me uncomfortable questions to ask you.
Yeah,
but I didn't look at my thing.
He's sleeping.
Did you text him, Carmen? Did he text you back?
No, I didn't.
Yeah.
I thought Spanish was going to try to call him in here. Do you want me to try to call him?
No, I don't care. I don't have anything uncomfortable anyway. It all went too well.
Yeah, I don't think there's anything like, I don't mean, you could ask me anything.
No, I know. I wasn't holding back. I just didn't know. I thought maybe you would have something that I didn't know about.
I can't think, you know.
Oh, you were going to confess
something. No, I was trying to think like what he would
say. He would say.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, listen, I'm super happy for your success. Tom Segura's Netflix specials are fantastic. I mean,
thanks, Mike.
Who do you like? Who are other comedians that you like? Like, I know you hang out with Rogan and all those guys, but I mean, like, I don't know. It's hard. What I'm saying is like, I think I'm pretty good at recommending comedians to people because there are some we watch and they're like, oh,
yeah.
We had Chad Daniels. Bert recommended him.
I'm a producer on his new special.
Oh, and then I watched him on your podcast, and I was like, yeah, poor guy. We came in. He was a trooper. He came in here, and we had a guy with reptiles in here, and we put a snake on his head. Chad, he wore it like a champion.
Chad's the best.
Yeah.
He has a new special that I'm a producer on that comes out in a month.
Now, what does that mean when you're a producer? You putting money up? I need to know this. I need to start producing stuff.
Well, you can.
Yeah.
So it just depends. Different arrangements for different specials and shows and movies. You know, sometimes you're creative producer. Sometimes you're strictly just money.
Right.
Sometimes it's like, you know, you make certain things happen.
Yeah.
And that's
why you're the
so there's different reasons why you can get a title like that.
See,
so. He's hilarious.
Oh, he was great.
Yeah.
It was the first time he was here. We roll the dice with first-timers sometimes and hope that it was good, and he was great. Like, he'd be a guy that would come back. There are some that won't.
Yeah.
Some that did not.
Who else do you like, though? Who do you like? We'll talk about who's good.
I mean, we have friends of the show. Like, we love Bobby Kelly.
It's funny because Nate Bargatze is really funny stand-up, but he wasn't a great guest. He's very kind of low-key and just didn't really do much.
That's me, though, too, honestly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
No, I brought it out of you today. You were great.
Yeah, talking
but
a lot, though.
Here's the thing, though. It happened, and it worked. Because, like, you guys were gracious enough about, you know what I mean? Like, you wanted it to go well.
Yeah, I always.
But like,
to
I'm
go
not
well.
Gonna. Yeah, but I'm saying like, I'm not the guy who's gonna come in like
tap dancing.
I'm gonna kill.
Yeah.
In this, like, it's happened, but I'm like, well, that's just because it happened.
Yeah.
Like, it wasn't like, oh, this is what happens when I walk in the room, dude. I remember, by the way, and a lot of comics probably have this too, like really. Like disappointing a radio guy one time,
yeah.
Where he saw me on Thursday at a club, and literally the show ends on Thursdays. You know, it's a one show typically in a club, right? And then two Friday, two
right.
Saturday. So I get off, and they're like, "Look, man, the guy from the local radio station, he is like flipping out about you from your set,
right?
Like he loved the show. Will you go do his show in the morning?" And I was like, "Yeah, okay." And we had like different press set up, so I show up and it's
where,
him.
Can you say where?
Yeah, name? it was in the Denver area.
Okay.
So I show up and he's there,
uh-huh.
And with a co-host. There's two guys, And I see the guy, and he's like, oh, hey, man. Oh, man. And then, like, they're setting up, like, coming out of a break. He's like, you don't understand. Like, this guy brought the house down. Like, keeps talking to his co-host. Right. Like, man, you don't, I mean, I got, and this, and the guy keeps, the other guy's like, okay, looking at me. So we come out of the break, and then the guy's like, all right. He's like, it's time. Go. And I was like, go. And then he was like telling his co-host, he was like, just relax, just watch. Like, just watch.
Like this, you're a magician.
Yeah. And I was like, yeah. And they're like, so you see this in the news? And I was like, yeah, no, that was pretty crazy. And they're like, what are you doing, man? He's like, and then we'd cut the break. He goes, I'm telling you, man, it was, I don't know what he's doing right now. Like, right in front of me. Like, he's doing, I don't know why he's doing this.
I don't want anybody ever to do their act in here. Although, like, we'll get some comedians sometimes that we'll talk about something and it'll make them think of something that they've done and they'll come out and it's funny. But no, I don't ever want that. Like, with nightmares for comedians, when they come in and they tell us, yeah, we got Bob and Tom and we're going to write out all these jokes and starter questions. And I'm like, oh, then don't do radio.
I know. I did one not too long ago where the producers came out and they're like, what do you want, like, as the lead-ins? And I was like, I don't know, whatever you want. And they were like, no, like, you got to tell us. And I was like, I'm serious, like, just ask me anything. And they're like, you have to have the lead-in, like, for him to, like, to ask you so that you can do your thing. And I was like, I don't have anything like that.
Yeah.
So, dude, I'm in the green room and they're having a break. They send in a second producer who's like, if you could just give us like, like just two or three, you know, things. I was like what?
Yeah.
And he goes, you know, so like what's going on in your home life? Like, I'm like, me and my wife, we had a baby. He's like, that would be great. So if he goes into that, I'm like, yeah, you can say that. I don't have a set
joke
answer.
For it,
And then they're like, God, all right. And so there's like another break. They bring the host in. They're like, he never comes in. And he's like, hey, man, so.
Why are you being difficult?
Yeah, he's like, you know, is everything like cool? I was like, dude, everything is fine.
Yeah.
Like, you can ask me anything. I mean, and he then starts doing a pre-interview himself with me.
Right.
And he's like, so that's a good thing. And he, like, looked at the guy. He's like, he could do it.
Oh, my God.
I was like, all right, man.
I would rather have you come in here and be awful and then either say to you, you're awful, or when you leave,
you're
say,
awful.
Then I would for, yeah, I mean, there's guys like Nate wasn't bad. He just wasn't, like, great.
Yeah.
And there's,
but he's a hilarious dude. He's just not,
like,
know.
I wouldn't say don't go see him.
Of course.
Sometimes, like I said about April. April, but, I don't know if she's
but
funny
Nate's
at all.
But personality is, like, he is a reserved, chill dude.
Oh, like,
but
what's
his
name?
I think the thing with Nate is I think he's so funny doing stand-up and stuff that, and like you said, he wasn't terrible or anything. It just was mismatched. I was like, I wanted him to, because I want people to go and see how funny
he is. I got you.
Yeah. Like, we hate Gary Valentine.
Really?
Yeah.
And Adam Ferrara.
That's Kevin James' brother.
Oh,
yeah.
And Adam, too?
Yeah.
What, and it was just were they terrible?
We gave Adam a second chance. He was worse the second time.
Wait, in that, was he, like, trying to sabotage? Or you mean just, like, didn't care?
He didn't care and thought he was a superstar.
Famous.
Yeah.
I think he thinks he's Tony Danza. Like, he literally came in and was like this. Was like, you know, and it was like, okay.
Yeah.
I guess we'll just ask you questions and you can say things and then.
Oh.
I don't know. It was weird. I just don't think he's funny. You know, Ralphie, we were great friends of Ralphie. Ralphie was fun sometimes, but he wasn't very good radio. He was disruptive. And, you know, we know who is good and who's not. I love that everybody hates Carlos Mencia.
Yeah.
Carlos will do and talk about anything on the radio. We had Carlos talk about almost killing himself over the Rogan stuff.
Are you serious?
Oh, yeah. Like we've had him. He brings it up.
Did he really?
Yeah. He's the most honest guy, and then I believe Carlos is married and has kids and all this stuff, but then talks about banging girls for hours. Like, he'll talk about anything. We love it, and I don't care what anybody says.
You're like, this is good radio.
So when Bert and Jay got into some heat, I immediately turned on Jay and was like, because you know, my Bert is my guy. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So when Jay. I trashed Jay pretty hardcore on the air, and it wasn't just because of that. Like, he was a dick. He said something to Ralphie that pissed me off one day, and I destroyed him. And his agent called me out of the, hey, buddy. And I'm like, oh, not happening, Frosty. And then Jay's like, what's the problem? I go, call the show and we'll talk about it. And it was an hour of me just telling him what a horrible human being he was. And he took every ounce of it, agreed with it, and apologized. And the next day sent me a dozen roses. And I went, all right. Then years later, he's coming in through town. And I'm like, I actually call Bert and I go, you know my dedication is to you. I won't have him on if you're like, I hate him. Bert's like, no, I don't care at all. I'm like, okay. So I had him on the show and we talked to him and he was like Mencia. So he's like, I'm so mentally beaten down that I've ruined relationships over it. He brought you up. He's like, I don't talk to Tom. I don't talk to Bert. He goes, I wish I had the opportunity to apologize to them and tell, and you know, you don't get that kind of honesty from somebody. And I said, Jay, you're famous. You've been on TV. You've been in movies. You're in goddamn Jerry Maguire. Now you're single. Let's do this. Let's get back out of the road. And he goes, I can't. I'm so mentally messed up that I have erectile dysfunction. And I'm like, you don't. That's the honesty you don't get from guests.
Yeah, so. that level of honesty is also awesome on radio, right? Yeah. Like, I mean, having that. And he was, by the way, always, let's say, prior to feeling beaten down and all
right.
that, great radio guy.
Yeah.
I guess when he would guess.
His impressions and all that.
Yeah. He would. You know, there's different approaches, I think, as when you study guests in radio. And he was like, I remember watching and seeing how different people do it. Like, Jay would... had the take over the room thing where he would go in and be like,
which doesn't always work
but if you can pull it off, it's like a magic trick almost,
right,
you know,
right.
And then like Fitzsimmons, I don't know if you
we love Fitzsimmons.
Very funny guy. He'll do the thing where like you think you're interviewing and all of a sudden you're like, damn, he's interviewing me right now.
He's
good at that. And he does it slick too.
He asked me a question one time and I answered it and I go, I can't believe I just answered that. And he goes, you know, he goes, last time I was here, you said the same thing. I go, you got me twice.
He's
talking
that
about my wife.
Yeah.
I was like, how did that just happen?
Turns it around.
Yeah.
On you.
He's good.
It's like a skill set.
And
both guys who wound up doing radio.
That's right.
Yeah. Well, look, I got to tell you, I'm so glad you came in here today.
Yeah, me too, man.
I'm glad that I feel like you're leaving and you were not like, why did I get up to do this?
No, this was great. I had a great time. Thank you very much.
And hopefully we have a good relationship now.
Yeah, dude. Let's do it again.
I have to tell you, if you and Bert, I mean, I'm sure you've talked about this 1,000 times, but will eventually you guys go do a tour together?
I hope we talked about it and, you know, it's hard to put those things together sometimes.
Right.
But we got to at least go do a show together. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like at least a one-off. And
something, or at least like three in like big
maybe
cities
that
are
yeah.
good for you guys. Like one in L.A., one in Philly.
Well, you know, we both have like crazy tour schedules for the rest of the year.
I'm going to produce that.
Then that's fine. Producing's good. But maybe like a 2020 run like that.
Yeah.
Like do a weekend and... You know, but we'll have to go. I don't know, man. We're going to have to work out this bus thing, you know?
Yeah, I know.
Who's going to get the big bed and all that?
Well, just go do like Motley Crue and take your own buses.
Oh, yeah.
Mine
will be the
tour.
One you sleep on. His will be the one you lose your life on. You know? It'll be the balance. Like, you want to sleep today? Go on Tom's bus.
You have an 8-month-old and you get to leave on Wednesdays?
Yeah.
How great is that life?
I know. It's pretty.
I mean, when my son was born and I was doing mornings, I would come to work, and at 10:01, my wife would be like, what time are you going to be home?
Oh.
I'm like, let me breathe a little
And then were
bit.
You had to be allowed, I'm assuming, to sleep, right? Like when you, like what about in the middle, like it's midnight, which
no.
for you,
no? No, in the middle of the night, we were up together.
What?
Yeah.
And you're going to do mornings?
It was rough. It was definitely rough.
Yeah,
I know.
He wasn't the happiest guy sometimes.
No.
And a lot of times he would miss the first break. The first break would be best of.
Yeah, well, like 6 or 6:15.
Yeah.
Then second kid, we didn't have our second kid till 6 years later. And I'm like, I have to be honest with you. I love this kid. My son and I are so tight.
Yeah.
I could never love another kid. And I ain't going through that crap anymore. But I was also doing afternoons at the time.
Yeah.
And I said, and I was just starting to become rich. So I was like, I will have this kid if we can have a nanny and all that other stuff. I don't want to change diapers. I don't want to do anything. And she was like, all right, we can do that. And I'm like, okay. So next one was simple. And I was doing afternoons. So.
We do the nanny. It's a huge help.
You have a nanny and a cleaning lady, and it's still stressful.
I know.
And I have
And a dope Sprinter van.
Yeah, and a Sprinter van. Yeah. And I have my parents, and my my parents are divorced, so I have two sets of parents, and I have
and they help
my
out.
Sister
yeah.
and my in-laws. I have so much help, and it's still I don't understand how people have kids.
Damn.
It's ridiculous.
Yeah.
Although now I want to have another kid, but I'm too old now, so I want to adopt one.
No more. Oh, yeah, yeah, that's cool.
I'll adopt one that I don't have to wipe its butt, like a three-year-old.
You can do that.
I know.
He wants to adopt one and let the kid know that he does not love that kid as much
right.
as his real
no,
kid.
I just want to.
It's a good message for those kids.
I don't love you.
They
as
don't
much.
Feel neglected enough. So you got to tell.
Way better than they had it before. Listen, I'm not. You're not at a 10. You're at a 7. But
have
seven,
you seen?
You're at a 4 before.
You seen Instant Family?
No.
You got to see Instant Family.
What is it?
That's a movie
that
I was in last year.
Oh, with Mark Wahlberg.
With Mark Wahlberg.
Yeah, yeah.
It's all about adoption. And it's based on, like, the writer-director, Sean Anders, he and his wife actually did this where they were, like, looking to adopt a kid. And then they found out, you know, that the adoption agencies are like, you know, there's a lot of adoptions where you adopt siblings because they're... There's that
right.
need,
well,
right?
To keep them together.
Yeah,
sure.
And
yeah.
He was like, "That's crazy." Right. And then they ended up adopting three siblings, and they really did this, you know.
Oh, so, really?
Yeah, yeah. They have, you know, they've had them now. I don't know, like 8-9 years or
My
something.
My wife laid it out pretty good to me. She was like, "What do you want to adopt?" And I go, "I don't know, a little boy. My mm-hmm. son's 12 now. He'll have somebody to look up to." And I go, "So maybe like a 3 or 4 year old boy." And she goes, "Okay." She goes, "Now, based on my experiences, most of these kids are affected somehow, drug affected mm-hmm. or have emotional problems." I go, "Okay." I go, "You're a therapist and I'm a patient guy. We can deal with that." And she goes, "I'm not worried about that." She goes, "You come home one day and then adopt a kid tries to hurt Juliana." I go, "Well, then I kill you." She goes, "Exactly my point." Okay,
my favorite part I'll of that wait. Whole thing is you said you're a patient guy.
Oh, with the kids, I'm very
this.
I'm
this wondering. Is my audition.
Oh, that?
Yeah, I volunteered to do this. See, that was on the podcast where that's the director, that's Sean.
Uh-huh.
And I was like, "Can you bring the audition footage?" And he was like, "You really want me to do that?" And I was like, "Yeah, I thought it'd be funny." And then as soon as it came up, you could see how hard I'm cringing. I'm like, "Please take it down."
It's so hard to watch yourself. See, I love this stuff. I love to be embarrassed. I love when these guys make fun of me. I
signed up for it
right.
with this, obviously.
Right,
but
right.
Yeah, I mean, if it's, you know.
Are you a good actor?
I think I'm all right.
Yeah.
I'm
god awful, but I'll keep doing auditions until something clicks.
Yeah, I mean, like, I enjoy it.
Yeah.
Right? So I think the fact that I actually enjoy it probably gives me something.
Right.
I mean, I'm sure I'm not going to win any awards. But,
you never know.
But it's, I like doing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think comedians make the best serious actors.
Some of them, yeah.
Yeah.
That's true. I mean, I would forget. Like, do you ever forget that Robin Williams is
totally.
One, right?
And totally.
Then,
yeah.
I never liked Robin Williams as a comedian.
Same.
But as an actor.
Yeah.
I'm the same.
Yeah. I mean, I love Good Morning Vietnam.
I used to not understand when he was killing. I was like, what's going on?
Oh, yeah. Hey,
and he was like, really kill. It wasn't like some people were laughing.
No,
it was
yeah.
like you'd see just waves of bodies moving.
Right. Cocaine works.
Yeah.
Yes. Yeah.
What about Steve Martin?
This is hilarious. This is true. Because, you know, I think your age has a lot to do with what you're exposed
right.
to. I didn't know he was a stand-up until I was like 20.
Yeah, you only see him in movies.
Because, I was born in 79. I think he stopped doing stand-up, you know, early
yeah,
80s or something.
80s,
so I'm in the Groundlings school, which is like the improv
yeah.
thing in like early 2000s in LA. And we're going around the room talking about like influences. And then somebody says like, and then Steve Martin's stand up. And I was like, stand up? And they're like, yeah. And I was like, he doesn't do stand up. And like everybody just turned their head and they're like, what? And they're like, it's one of the greatest stand ups of all time. And I was like, Steve Martin.
Uh-huh. And one of the biggest.
Like, that's what they're like. Yeah. They're like, he did Arena.
Yeah.
And I was like, how do I not know this?
Who are your influences?
I don't know. I mean, I remember first seeing Bill Cosby himself, that
yeah.
special. The Eddie Murphy stuff, I would lose my mind when
yeah,
I was
we
a
all
kid,
love that, yeah.
right? And then, I think when I started doing stand up, seeing Attell was
yeah.
right before I started doing stand up. It was Chris Rock,
yeah,
because that was like again, it's like I'm in college and he puts out end of high school he puts out Bring
Bigger
the Pain
and Bring
then
the pain,
then
yeah.
Bigger and Black, and I was like, just out of my mind. Like, this is the funniest thing I've ever seen.
Yeah.
And it was so on the, like, on point with all the topics of the time. And and so, but then when I saw Attell, I was like, this is my identity.
My kind of speed,
and then I just, like, dressed like him and talked like him for, like, 3 years.
Yeah, that cadence.
Oh, yeah, totally. And I worked with him one time. He was like, stop doing my cadence. Like, okay.
What about Carlin? I never thought Carlin was funny. I think he's a genius, but I don't think he's funny.
I thought he was really funny in the way that, like, the cleverness.
The turn of phrase, he was really good at that.
Also, like, in like seeing it as a piece of writing, right? Like, it started.
That's the thing.
Here.
I read his book and I was like, "This is funny."
Yeah,
yeah, that's interesting.
But it wasn't like,
not like watching Eddie Murphy Raw.
Like, my favorite line from Carlin was when he was making fun of the Y2K people,
right?
And it's like a throwaway. It's not even like one of his things. And he was, because you know you're stuck at a party talking to some idiot who's like, oh, Y2K, whatever happened to that? Like, that was his... I fell out of my chair laughing at him pretending to be that guy, but not like, you know. Yeah.
What's your favorite movie?
My favorite movie?
Yeah.
Oh, man.
I like a top two or three. I always just think you could know so much about a person. Like, when I was single, I'd ask girls, what's your favorite movie? And that would be a deal breaker.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know. I was thinking, like... The other day, I was so surprised that even though I'd said whenever this is on, I'll watch it, I was like, man, I'm about to be 40, and I'm still watching it, no matter what part it's on, was Coming to America.
Oh, yeah.
You know? Like, it's still...
So, when we had Arsenio on, that was one of the reasons why I want to have him on.
Oh, my God.
He said it's a done deal. They've signed contracts for the next one. He said it's not a done deal
whether he's in it, though.
Right, right. Eddie signed it. He goes, we've had so many scripts over the years.
Yeah.
And he goes, and Eddie finally called me one day, he goes, you have to come over and read this. And he said it, and I go, well, good. I hope it happens. He goes, no, it's signed. It's happening.
It's happening.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, that's hilarious. Wait, what's your favorite movie?
I mean, Goodfellas, but yeah, I mean, we were talking about the other day about Midnight Run.
Yeah.
Midnight Run is one of the best movies ever. I don't know. Goodfellas is my go-to.
I love thrillers. Like, I love French Connection.
Yeah.
The only thing that takes me out of The Fugitive, because I love that movie, is when he jumps off that train, because it's right before, like, CGI.
Oh, yeah.
But, like, I love those type. I love thrillers like that, you know?
Oh, Tom, I think we became better friends than Bert and I, for sure.
100%.
Yeah.
Dude, you got to drop him.
Yeah. I mean, I don't know if I'm going to drop him, but he definitely is. Like, I don't have to.
Dude, block his number for a week. Right. Just do that. So he's like, why does he keep going to voicemail?
Are you kidding me? He's so Hollywood now. It's good luck if I get him to return a text.
No, I know.
We were saying last time he was in that this may be the last time he comes in.
Well, yeah, he went on our cruise during Sober October.
Yeah.
And that's a way to end it, because he's not going to be happy sober.
No.
So he was miserable on our cruise.
And all the listeners.
Although I have to tell you, he was pretty fun.
Looks sober there.
Yeah. That's
that was
different
a couple
one.
Years ago.
Can you please take my name off if you're showing him?
He was fun, as fun as you could be sober.
Yeah, yeah.
But I could tell he was secretly miserable the whole time.
Sure.
And I said, he's finally reached Hollywood size where we won't get... Like, I don't even know if we'll get him on the show anymore. So keep breaking him down mentally so we can stay friends.
Yeah, no, I'll try. I'll try my best. Yeah.
This is great. All right, well, Tom Segura is going on our next cruise.
Love to.
Have you ever been on one?
I've never done one of those.
Really?
No.
See, ours are easy because you do one show and you're done, and the rest of it's vacation.
That's kind
of
nice.
Right. Like, in Practical Jokers, they have, like, three different shows, and there's everywhere you go. Ours, you can get away from everything.
I feel like they're doing, like, six cruises a year now or something.
I bet they're making so much money.
Yeah.
I bet they're making so much money.
They're so nice, too.
That's what everyone says.
It's, like, unnerving.
Well, because they were just four Jamokes from New York, and then all of a sudden now they're millionaires, so why wouldn't they be nice? They gotta, and they also realized eventually you can't do this show anymore because everybody knows who you are. So we better find something else to keep the boat rolling, and they did.
Yeah.
And they're even nice to, like, trolls on Twitter and stuff. I saw that Joe, they did something with some art thing where they had photos up, and they're like, "Oh, must be nice being a millionaire. You know, nobody would go if you weren't." And he goes, "Actually, I paid for everything." And he goes, "We just wanted people to see our stuff. I hope that you have a dream that you follow, and good luck in your life." And I'm like,
"Wow,
that's not how you treat people. You're just like, shut it. I'm rich.
Yeah,
that's my D.
No, they're really Sal. He's like the sweetest guy.
Yeah,
the whole crew. Yeah, they're really good guys.
Well, look, I gotta tell you, I loved having you in here today. I just looked at the clock, and we've been talking for an hour and a half.
Have we really?
Yeah, no commercials. I'm sure somebody is in this building is pacing right now. Yeah.
Sales.
Yeah, sales. Oh, there's this little mean black lady who's gonna come down here and yell at me.
We're gonna have to paint the studio yellow and red.
Oh, man.
Tom Segura, if you have tickets, enjoy his show tonight and tomorrow night at the Tampa Theater. If not, check out his podcast, Your Mom's House, and
the
his
movie.
Netflix specials and the movie with Mark Wahlberg. Now, this came and went already?
Yeah, yeah. It just hit like iTunes, on-demand stuff this week.
How many times you lay in bed and you're like, now me and Mark Wahlberg are going to do a bunch of movies together.
Oh, man.
We cop movie, yeah. Buddy movie next.
I found the way in when I was on set to talk to him.
Yeah.
Because, like, you know, you'd like kind of run jokes by people. Like, you think, I'll be like, does this work? And, like, people would laugh, you know. I was like, I'm going to go say it to Mark. And I walk up to Mark. I'm like, hey, man. He was like, yeah. So I was like, damn.
Cold face.
And then totally. Oh, he blew me off one time. He didn't blow me off. He just destroyed what I was like making a joke about a guy who was like in the crowd.
Right.
And like I ran it by people. Like I just to see like is it, and everyone's laughing. I tell him he was like, nah, he's probably had a hard life.
Oh,
no.
Oh, you're a good person.
So then I was like, oh, man, this sucks. And I sat down, just like head between. I was like, And like even like my cast were like, what's up? I was like, yeah, Mark didn't like that joke. Oh. And, you know, I was just crushed. But then, so then I have like third day, I'm doing a scene with him. It's just me and him. And free agency had just started for football, and I knew he's a sports guy, but I was like, whatever. Dude, I bring up some free agency move that way. You see who got cut or got picked up. He just was like, yeah, man. And then it was like we were general managers. Right. And, like, so, and I would like kind of know what he was talking about, but yeah. I was like, yeah. Like, yeah, big year. I had no idea he was talking about.
I always worry that somebody like that is making up sort of. What about Fred Nelson? Like, oh, yeah, Fred Nelson.
Oh,
yeah,
Freddie.
There is no Fred Nelson.
Yeah. Well, I would, you know, we would sometimes shoot and we'd have weekends off and, like, he would go to the Bahamas on his private jet and post something and then we'd be back on Monday in Atlanta shooting this movie and I would, like, walk up to him. I hadn't seen him in, let's say, a few days and I was like, yo, that man, the Bahamas, that looked nice. And he was like, dude, did you see that Jamarcus? Whatever,
sports.
Ignore completely what I had said. And if I asked him anything, I was like, yeah, man, you know, this car, anything about like, you know, things or business, anything like that. He was just like, I don't know what you're talking about, but Brady's going to sign another deal and he's going to be back for another couple of years. And I was like, okay.
He only speaks sports.
Yeah.
Man.
And that makes sense too, because you're like, that's kind of the great equalizer.
Right.
And if like you're super famous and you don't know what people, but like you keep it sports, then all of a sudden someone feels relaxed, you know? It's like.
If I said something to Mark Wahlberg and he went, I don't know anything about that, I would never open my mouth again.
Oh, I know. But now you know if you ever see him, you just got to be like, Patriots, man. And he's going to be like, yes.
We hung out with Vince Vaughn one time.
Yeah.
And I was like, Vince Vaughn is so great in so many movies that all I need is a picture with him. I don't care if he hates me. But I will try my best to make this work out good. And we had interviewed him on the air one time before. And I don't know how I got into it, but we started talking. He put a little effort into talking to us.
Mm-hmm.
And then it came up about something about guns.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, man. We were like this now. And he was like, "You got guns? I got guns.
He loves guns.
Yeah, and then he's like, I got my concealed carry. I go, me too. And then he pulled one out. I pulled mine out. And he's like, I got it in like four different states. And he's pulling other ones out. He's like, I got one in Vegas. I got one in Chicago. And I was like, oh, man, this is good. And he's like, and then I was about to have a daughter, and he had daughters. You know, when you have daughters, I go, when you have daughters, you need guns. You got guns. That's why I got guns. And we were back and forth. And then later on, we interviewed him, and we told him. I said, I was worried about it. And then we started talking about guns. And he goes, then before you know it, you were like, I can't shake Vaughn. I can't get him off me. I go, exactly. I couldn't get out of the conversation at that point. But once you connect on something.
This is going too good. We have to end it.
Yeah, I was like, let's just leave it at that. Let's take a picture and walk away so we can go away. I was like, that guy's pretty cool. He talks about guns.
Yeah. You found your in, man.
Yeah. And I didn't have to fake like I knew sports and Fred Nelson.
Wahlberg, sports, Vaughn, guns.
Dude, imagine if you like are sitting there with like Michael Jordan or something. You know,
ugh.
Like you'd be like, hey, you're so good. And then like you don't know, you know, you bring up, what are you going to bring up? His shoes or something?
I've been in that situation with Deion Sanders before.
Yes.
And I was in a limo with Deion alone. And I'm like, what do I talk about? And I don't know anything about sports. This was right after the Dallas Cowboys had won the Super Bowl.
Yeah.
And I think we started talking about Disney World because he was going there with his kids. Dion was so sweet, and he opened up, and we're talking about Disney World, and I'm like, and then he taught me two sexual terms, old-fashioned and neck up. He's like, I get me some neck up. I'm like, I don't want to ask. Then finally, I'm like, what's neck up? And he goes, what's above your neck? And I went, oh.
Yeah.
I was young.
Yeah.
I was like, I get it now.
I feel like now he would not say that.
No. Now,
I would, if I was hanging out with Dion now, I would pretend to be religious because I know he is.
Yeah.
Just to see like where it goes. I'd be like, man, you got to put it all in God. And he'd be like, you know what I mean? Truth, dog. Like,
he's full of crap. He's full of crap. I ain't buying that religious thing at all.
He's hosing all of us.
I said, one day I'm going to get married and have kids, and I'm going to tell my kids, neck up. Dion taught me that.
Neck up. Yeah. Neck up.
That's the one thing. Not yet, because my son's only 12.
Old fashioned? Was that the first one?
Yeah, old fashioned. He goes, I got to get me some neck up, at least an old fashioned. And I was like, I don't know what any of those things mean.
Man, I bet he got a bunch of neck up back in the day.
Oh, yeah.
For
sure. We rolled up in the strip joint. And he was trying to get some girls to get out there and get some neck up. Mm-hmm. And then one girl just gave him an old fashioned, he said.
Really?
Yeah.
Good for him.
I know, right? Yeah. I was like, I'm not mad.
What a beautiful story. Yeah.
I don't like him anymore. So I don't.
Really?
He's kind of a douche. So I don't really care. Like, most of the time, I have a lot of great stories that I'll keep in forever.
Yeah.
But those kind of things I don't care about.
Yeah.
This has been so much fun.
Yeah, man. I had a great time. Thank you for having me.
Thank you. You have to walk back now. You can't take
Okay.
Now that it went well, you're okay. Yeah, dude, Bert, we've never sent a car for Bert.
You shouldn't.
Ever. Nope, you're right. Thank you. Tom Segura, we'll take a quick break. I got to go pee. I'm going to be honest with you. It's going to be a long-ass break. We're way behind. But we'll be back. It's the Mike Calta Show.
The Mike Calta Show on 102.5 The Bone.